2027. aldian Euskal Unibertsitateak antolatutako udako ikastaroen askunde ekonomikoa bizi baldintzen eta gizarte inklusioaren gobekuntza izenekoari hasiera eman behar dugu. Vamos a proceder a la inauguración del curso Crecimiento económico, mejoran las condiciones de vida y la inclusión social de la 27ª edición de los cursos de verano organizados por la Universidad del País Vasco. En primer lugar, excusar la asistencia de la vicelehendakari del Gobierno Vasco, que por problemas de agenda no ha podido estar con nosotros en esta inauguración. Euskal Herriko Unibertsitatearekin lankidetzan egindako ikastaro hauen bidez, Eustatek harremanetan jarri nahi du komunitate zientifikoa eta haren erabiltzaile nagusiak. Egungo gizarteetako fenomeno esanguratsuak aztertzeko eta interpretatzen laguntzeko. Eustat, a través de estos cursos, en colaboración con la Universidad del País Vasco, quiere poner en contacto a la comunidad científica con sus principales usuarios con el fin de analizar aquellos fenómenos relevantes en las sociedades actuales y ayudar a interpretarlos. En esta inauguración nos acompaña la directora de este curso, Cristina Prado, y el vicerrector de profesorado de la Universidad del País Vasco, don Juan Juncilla, a quien paso la palabra.
Sí. Muchas gracias, Egunon. Cristina, Josu, en primer lugar quería pues daros la bienvenida a todos y agradecer vuestra presencia. Para mí es un honor, como vicerrector de la Universidad del País Vasco, pues tomar parte de esta inauguración en este curso que organiza el Eustat con la colaboración de los cursos de verano. Y también quería pues saludaros en nombre del rector, que bueno, pues que no ha podido venir, pero que me ha pedido que en su nombre os salude. No voy a entrar, evidentemente, en la materia del curso, no soy experto en ello, pero sí me gustaría destacar el enorme interés que creo que tiene este tema, ¿no? Por la implicación que tiene en la vida diaria de todos nosotros, ¿no? Las sociedades democráticas se caracterizan porque generan espacios favorables para que se den las condiciones en las que el bienestar se pueda generalizar. Y en ese sentido, los últimos años hemos vivido un periodo de bonanza económica y creo que hemos sido testigos de cómo esta riqueza, esta bonanza económica, ha permitido extender esa cultura de bienestar, esa sociedad de bienestar y también el desarrollo de políticas de inclusión. Pero quizás en este momento en el que, bueno, pues aunque a algunos políticos les cueste decir la palabra crisis, pues sí parece que hay una cierta desaceleración, sí hay un momento de inversión en el ciclo económico, pues sí es un momento de hacer una reflexión, puesto que puede este cambio de ciclo incidir de forma importante sobre las políticas que hasta ahora se han venido desarrollando en la Unión Europea, ¿no? Si se produce realmente una correspondencia entre crecimiento económico y mejora de las condiciones de vida, pues sería oportuno reflexionar en este momento en el que parece que el ciclo económico cambia, qué decisiones se deben adoptar, ¿no?, en la sociedad y fundamentalmente en las políticas públicas para, en la medida de lo posible, mantener este tipo de políticas, ¿no? Yo creo que el curso, estoy seguro de ello, pues cuenta con un interés añadido pues por estas circunstancias, ¿no? Y este es un foro que me parece muy adecuado para que se produzca esta reflexión, ¿no? No sin hacer una última observación, y es que no deberíamos olvidar tampoco que hay muchas personas que viven, en algunos casos malviven, fuera de la Unión Europea y cuyas condiciones de vida se ven en muchos casos afectadas por decisiones que tomamos en esta Unión Europea o en otras partes del mundo, ¿no? Y a veces, cuando manejamos datos sobre este tipo de situaciones, pues no siempre los incluimos o no siempre los tenemos en cuenta, ¿no? Entonces, es muy importante que a la hora de tomar decisiones, el instrumento de medida contemple todas las variables, de forma que realmente las decisiones que se adopten sean realmente las más adecuadas. Bueno, yo no quería alargarme más, simplemente reiterar mi bienvenida y mi agradecimiento y desearos, pues como no, unos cursos muy, muy provechosos. Muchas gracias.
Gracias, Juanjo. Crecimiento económico, mejora en las condiciones de vida y la inclusión social. Esta va a ser la pregunta a la que se trate de dar respuesta en este curso de verano a través de las diferentes aportaciones y ponencias. Las diferentes respuestas se tratarán de abordar desde diferentes puntos de vista: el estadístico, el de los analistas de la universidad, el de la administración pública y el de los que trabajan en el mundo del trabajo social. A través de todos ellos se analizarán los diferentes aspectos y dimensiones que suponen las condiciones de vida de las personas y su evolución en los últimos 15-20 años. Tomando un punto de vista teórico, podemos decir que el crecimiento económico de una economía queda definido por el crecimiento del Producto Interior Bruto por habitante, cuyo aumento provocará, casi por definición, un aumento del nivel de vida medio en términos de bienes y servicios consumidos por habitante. Pero ante todo esto, cabe hacerse la pregunta de si este crecimiento provocará una mejora del bienestar de todos los miembros de la población de esa economía. La respuesta a esta pregunta está muy abierta, debido a que existe un cierto número de efectos secundarios que pueden afectar la intensidad de la mejora del bienestar asociada a dicho crecimiento. Así pues, siguiendo con el análisis teórico, podemos decir que el crecimiento económico lleva aparejado una serie de consecuencias que incidirán en un mayor o menor grado en el bienestar que origina. Entre estas consecuencias podemos destacar las siguientes: desigualdades en los ingresos. El crecimiento económico, según las teorías actuales, puede provocar tanto un aumento como una reducción de las desigualdades, dependiendo de las circunstancias y de las respuestas de la economía de mercado y la del mercado laboral. En el empleo, el crecimiento económico a largo plazo solo puede sostenerse con aumentos de productividad de los trabajadores, pero también hay que tener en cuenta que en momentos altos del ciclo existen traspasos de trabajo de la economía informal a la formal. También hay que unir crecimiento económico con avances y ampliación de la cultura del ocio. Las familias. Al aumentar la riqueza de las sociedades, las familias tienden a ser más pequeñas, donde un mayor número de personas, jóvenes y mayores, viven solas. Esta disminución en el tamaño de las familias implica reducción del nivel de vida material. La administración. El crecimiento económico puede dar lugar a un mayor papel del gobierno, tanto porque éste crea demanda de servicios públicos como porque proporciona recursos para responder a dichas demandas. La administración tiene un papel fundamental en la distribución de los beneficios del crecimiento económico en toda la población. En el ámbito de la educación, el alto grado de desarrollo económico está asociado a los niveles de educación para todos. Mayor número de padres se pueden permitir una buena educación para sus hijos. En la emigración, un fuerte crecimiento económico atrae a la emigración procedente de otros países más pobres, mejorando su bienestar, aunque pudiendo crear tensiones en el país de destino. Medio ambiente. La relación entre el crecimiento económico y medio ambiente es el más controvertido, pudiendo constituir, por una parte, una amenaza y, por otra, también puede proporcionar los medios adecuados para crear un entorno saludable. Y, por último, en las aspiraciones en las personas. Actualmente se admite que el aumento del nivel de vida aumenta también el nivel de aspiraciones de las personas. Conseguido cierto nivel de bienestar, las personas no se sienten considerablemente mejor. Centrándonos más en concreto en dar respuesta a la pregunta que plantea este curso dentro del ámbito de la Comunidad Autónoma de Euskadi, podemos decir que desde un punto de vista económico, la economía vasca ha experimentado en los últimos 20 años una profunda transformación, lo que ahora se está denominando la primera transformación de la economía vasca. Una transformación tanto cuantitativa, desde la aportación de riqueza, como cualitativa, en cuanto a la aportación de diferentes sectores económicos en términos de riqueza, grado de modernización y empleo, superándose a todas luces con notable éxito. También se ha dado un cambio sin precedentes durante este periodo en el desarrollo alcanzado por la Administración Pública Vasca, tanto por su aportación directa como a través de sectores como la educación y sanidad, no solo en términos económicos, sino en términos de liderazgo en todos los ámbitos sociales. La actuación de la Administración durante esta etapa no solo ha estado encaminada a impulsar políticas de suelo o regeneración económica, sino a tejer una auténtica red de ayuda y soporte a través de las políticas de redistribución social. Durante estos últimos 20 años también se ha atravesado una crisis demográfica sin precedentes, caracterizada por la detención del crecimiento vegetativo, reducción drástica de las tasas de natalidad y un envejecimiento paulatino de la población, tan solo modificada en parte por el aporte de la nueva inmigración. Las transformaciones demográficas y económicas mencionadas han desembocado en un cambio significativo de las condiciones de vida de la Comunidad Autónoma de Euskadi. Dichos cambios hacen referencia a una diversificación de los modos de vida y de las pautas de las relaciones sociales. Este contexto de bonanza económica provoca un incremento en las aspiraciones materiales e inmateriales, una diversificación en las pautas de consumo, donde el ocio y los gastos derivados de la afirmación individual adquieren una relevancia especial. No obstante, es evidente que existen algunos límites que condicionan el éxito en la lucha contra la precariedad, explicando la resistencia, la desaparición de algunas formas de pobreza grave. En estos límites destacan los problemas que afectan a las personas que no disponen de ingresos suficientes para independizarse, colectivo en aumento. Jóvenes adultos que se ven afectados por problemas de inestabilidad o bajos ingresos en el empleo, dificultades en el acceso a la vivienda de precios asequibles. También debe mencionarse el alto riesgo de precariedad de algunos tipos de familias monoparentales encabezados por mujeres menores de 45 años o de colectivos de inmigrantes. A todo esto se une la incógnita del impacto de la situación económica actual, del final de un proceso de creación masiva de empleo y fuerte aumento de precios básicos sobre los niveles de precariedad. Situación que será, a buen seguro, motivo de intervenciones, debate y discusión en diferentes ponencias de este curso. Esperamos que este curso sirva para aumentar nuestros conocimientos sobre el tema y aprovechemos la ocasión de contar entre nosotros con varios expertos en el tema. Y bueno, dentro de 5 minutos, el profesor Calvón de Boch, de la Universidad de Antwerp, nos va a impartir su primera lección, Crecimiento económico y análisis de las condiciones de vida en el entorno europeo. Es que recasco de noi.
Bueno, egunon guztioi, vamos a dar comienzo a este primer día de curso de verano, que como el resto de días, nuestro cometido será el dar respuesta a la pregunta que se plantea en el título de este curso, que es ¿crecimiento económico mejora en las condiciones de vida y en la inclusión social? Aunque esta pregunta toca hacérnosla en un momento en que existe una gran preocupación por el menor crecimiento de la economía, por discernir si tenemos o no tenemos crisis o por cuánto va a durar, la reflexión que nos ocupa en este curso es fundamental, ya que solamente puede ser realizada en el largo plazo, que es donde verdaderamente se pueden analizar los cambios que tienen que ver con los aspectos relacionados con las condiciones de vida de la población o con la pobreza de una sociedad. Este primer día está dedicado a analizar el tema que nos ocupa de una forma más general. Conjugaremos la perspectiva económica y sociológica, también conjugaremos la teoría y los resultados. Y primeramente en el ámbito de la Unión Europea y posteriormente iremos aterrizando en lo que es nuestra realidad en la Comunidad Autónoma de Euskadi. Para todo ello y primeramente contamos con el profesor holandés Karel van den Bos, que nos impartirá dos ponencias. La primera de ellas se centrará más en las condiciones en el crecimiento económico relacionado con las condiciones de vida y en la segunda analizará más desde el punto de vista del crecimiento económico y la pobreza, todo ello en el marco de la Unión Europea. Un breve currículum sobre el profesor van den Bos es que es doctor en Ciencias Políticas y Sociales por la Universidad de Amberes. Actualmente trabaja como profesor investigador en el Centro Helman de Leck de Política Social de la Universidad de Amberes y es profesor también de Estadística 2 en dicha universidad. Es jefe de proyecto en dicho centro, lo que le supone coordinar todos los campos de investigación relativos a la pobreza y desigualdades en los ingresos. Es el jefe de equipo de su país en el proyecto SARE entre Bélgica y Holanda, relacionado con la salud, jubilación, envejecimiento para la población de edad igual o superior a los 50 años y también promueve proyectos de investigación como el impacto social y económico del envejecimiento en Flandes y en Europa y el impacto de los servicios financieros y la exclusión financiera y un largo etcétera. También tiene numerosos premios y honores académicos, entre ellos, a modo de ejemplo, pues podemos decir que es editor jefe de una revista sociológica holandesa, es miembro de del grupo de expertos en la encuesta SILC de Bélgica, así como fue premio Segers en el año 2000, por el mejor estudio sobre humanidades, con especial atención a los problemas sociales, y está laureado, entre otras cosas, por la Real Academia Flamenca de Bélgica. Y bueno, y para terminar, pues es titular de gran número de publicaciones y trabajos de investigación. Y si todo un poco está ya preparado, pues podríamos empezar la lección.
It is a pleasure for me to be talking to you about this subject, and because I need a lot of time, it's a big subject, I will start right away. Originally the presentation was in two parts, but I have put them more or less together, so because I would like to illustrate theoretical points immediately with empirical data. The context of the presentation and maybe of this conference is the EU Lisbon strategy. This was set out by the European Council of March 2000 in Lisbon.
En el 1, canal 1. ¿Va? No se oye nada. Los primeros momentos de puesta a punto del curso, pero parece que el sistema de traducción todavía no está preparado.
So now the translation is coming. Okay. This European Council Lisbon, they formulated a very ambitious goal for the European Union, as you can read, to make it the most dynamic and competitive knowledge-based economy in the world, capable of sustainable economic growth with more and better jobs and greater social cohesion and respect for the environment. But the question, this is very ambitious. The question is, implicitly there are four goals: sustainable economic growth, more and better jobs, greater social cohesion, and respect for the environment. Are they mutually supportive? Is it easy to reach all four of them? Or are they maybe in conflict with each other? And this brings us to the title of the lecture, where I look in particular at the relation between economic growth, employment, so jobs, and social cohesion. It's useful to have a working definition of economic growth, and the most commonly used definition is increase in gross domestic product That is the total of all goods and services produced in the economy, and this per head of the population, and of course at constant prices, so inflation is not economic growth. This definition is criticized quite rightly, because it is not a good measure of well-being, but well, it's the definition which I will stick with. Secondly, we have to distinguish between short-term booms and depressions. The best short-term changes in economic growth, but what we are interested in is, of course, long-term sustainable economic growth. Below on the presentation, I will abbreviate economic growth to EG. There are actually contrasting views about, well, the benefits of economic growth. Economists will say that economic growth means that you have more goods and services. You have more of everything, and so people can consume more, and this implies higher standard of living, and that this means greater well-being. Political scientists will say, well, economic growth, this often solves problems of distribution. Everyone can be made better off. You can raise taxes. The government gets more, while people also still have higher income. And this enhances political stability. So economic growth is a good thing. But if you ask the man on the street, or, well, not on the street, but in this on the internet, it's a Yahoo forum, which I stumbled across when doing my research. And in this forum, the question was asked, how does economic growth enhance the living conditions of the ordinary resident? And there were two answers. The first one says, well, not a lot, but maybe people feel better. The second answer says, well, it doesn't help, because economic growth only makes the richer more rich, and the poor do not benefit. And this seems to be only two answers, of course, but this seems to be a quite commonly held view among ordinary people. But, well, who is right? Economists are the men, the Yahoo forum people. Well, there are a lot of reasons why economic growth indeed does not increase well-being. Here I list a few of them. First of all, I said, well, the gains of economic growth go to the people already well off. And so economic growth enhances inequality. The second point is that, well, economic growth is only realized because people have to work ever harder. More hours, more people in employment, and so people are not really, really better off. Another bit opposite point is that, well, as we have economic growth, people use this to work less, and therefore it's a bit squandered in laziness. People take it. Then economic growth is bad for the planet, because economic growth means that the natural resources, like oil, etc., are used up, and we have ever more pollution. Then people say, well, economic growth is used to buy privacy. This may be, I will come back to that later. Then economic growth, if you have high economic growth in the country, it means that more migrants, legal or illegal, will come into the country, and this will dilute the gains of economic growth. And finally, you might say the more you have, the more people want, so people are not really better off if their income increases. And there may be a point to this. This is a comparison between growth in GDP for a number of countries. We have Canada. Oh, I'm not sure you can read this. So you have here Canada, Germany, United Kingdom, and Sweden. The red line is the GDP per capita, so that is economic growth, which is positive in all countries. And then the blue lines are two indexes of well-being. Does not matter much what goes into this index of well-being, but it takes account of consumption, but also of inequality, of pollution, and a number of other aspects. But interesting thing is that, where you see in Canada, left upper corner, well, their well-being increases more or less in line with economic growth. But in Germany, the right upper corner, there we see that actually economic well-being goes down according to this index, one of the indices. And the same is true for Sweden in the left bottom corner and United Kingdom in the right bottom corner. So there are actually reasons to think, well, economic growth does not necessarily lead to increases in well-being. But this is only the starting point. What I am not going to discuss now are six points or dimensions. I will talk relation between economic growth and inequality, economic growth and household formation, economic growth, employment and unemployment, economic growth, life satisfaction and aspirations, economic growth, poverty and deprivation, and finally I will make some, well, rather tentative conclusions for economic policy, well, policy in general. What will I not talk about? First of all, economic growth, depletion of using up of national resources and pollution. Not because it is unimportant, but because it is very important. But it is such a big subject that I cannot really treat this in these 2 hours. And also it is not a subject where I am at home with. So I leave this to the side, but it might be a good subject for another lecture or 2 lectures. Same is true of economic growth and migration. There is certainly a relation there, and it is an important subject, but it's not my where I am at home with. Finally, of course, there is the big question. Supposing economic growth is a good thing, how do you promote economic growth? How do you make sure that we have economic growth? And there is enormous literature, which I cannot do justice to, so I leave this to the side too. So I come now to my first point. First, for me, economic growth and inequality. And the question is, does economic growth enhance inequality? Well, first of all, it is clear that it cannot do so everywhere and all the time. If economic growth would increase inequality, well, then inequality would be sky high by now compared to the 18th century, which is not the case. There are good reasons to believe that before 1800, inequalities were much higher than they are now. But yet, in many situations, economic growth may indeed lead to inequality. So at this point, I will start with the Kuznets curve, which you may have heard about, which is really a concept out of development economics, and you might think not relevant for the EU, but the mechanism behind this curve is still valid, which as I will show. This is less so if the economy restores equilibrium quickly. Of course, it is important what income. I have talked about inequality in general, and not on purpose, not inequality of what. Well, I will discuss that too. And then some empirical evidence. So the Kuznets curve was a hypothesis proposed by Simon Kuznets, I think somewhere in the 1970s or maybe earlier. And what he says is that as a country develops, inequality first tends to increase. And then after a while, as a country develops more and more, it decreases again. And this is partly a theoretical deduction and partly what he deduced or induced from the data that were available at that time. And it, indeed, in the 1970s, this was more or less true. If you look at the broad pattern of data, but no long, this is no longer the case. But it is useful, this Kuznets curve is still useful as a frame for thinking about the relation between between economic growth and inequality. because suppose that you have two sectors in the economy or in a country. You have the, and this is before development takes off, you have the traditional sector, say sustainable agriculture, where people have very low incomes, and then a more modern sector, say manufacturing, where people have higher incomes. And initially, we assume that the traditional sector is dominant, so almost everyone works in this sustainable agriculture. Now, if for some reason the modern sector takes off, for instance because the country opens up to the world economy and there's a boom in manufacturing, then inequality will increase because the wages in this modern sector will get higher because there's great demand for there will be great demand for skilled labor and also will increase in size because more people will start working in this traditional sector. But that adaptation will be slow because people are not well, people in the traditional sector are not well adapted to work in the traditional sector, in the modern sector. But after some decades or a longer time, more and more people will move to the modern sector, will move to manufacturing, will get the skills they need for this sector, and the differences will become smaller. And also the modern sector will become dominant, and this will mean that after a while inequality starts to decrease again. this, of course, is a mechanism that applies to less developed countries. But you might think that the mechanism where you have one sector with high wages and other sectors with low wages is still valid for even for developed countries. So you might think about, for instance, if you look at services versus manufacturing, especially in some, for some kind of services, financial services and so on, wages are high. If this sector develops, then this will imply an increase in inequality because people will in the sector will earn more and more people will flow into it. it also applies to regions. If within a country, the richer regions gain more of an economic growth, then inequality will of course increase. And this kind of shifts may indeed explain why we do not see further reductions in inequality, why inequality does not decline as the Kuznets curve hypothesizes. And furthermore, the Kuznets curve will not apply if the labor market functions well. The more quickly people flow into the sector with high wages, which is expanding, the flatter the Kuznets curve will become, and the less inequality will increase. yes, I will skip a bit. And actually, more modern equilibrium models, economists have worked out general equilibrium models of the relation between economic growth and inequality. And they look at the rewards of labor and capital. Where capital includes human capital. sorry about this. And then it turns out that actually there is no clear relation between economic growth and inequality on the theoretical level. It can go both ways, depending on the situation and on the distribution of labor and capital. then we have to ask the question, okay, but economic growth may enhance inequality or reduce inequality, but inequality of what? And it is clear that economic growth will more directly affect individual market incomes. What people get, income people get from the market, that is in wages or self-employment income or capital income. But of course, what matters for the living standard is not market income as such, but their household disposable income, their total household income from all sources. And there are two main factors which mediate the relation between market income and disposable income. This is first of all household formation, who lives with whom. And secondly, government redistribution. The government redistributes a lot of market income in taxes and gives it to other people in benefits. And of course, this both factors are important determinants of inequality, independent of market income. And they may change over time, as we will see. And especially if we include the government in the whole picture, then there is what I have called the wages and benefit Kuznets mechanism, which is that supposing economic growth increases the real wages, so people with wages will have higher incomes. But the benefits in most European countries are not linked to the real wage. They only are, they only keep up with prices. And this will mean that inequality between households with wage earners and on the other hand households who are dependent on benefits, they will increase in periods when there's an economic boom and where wages, real wages, are increased quite rapidly. And this process is reinforced if pensions, and pensions are actually the main component of benefits, state benefits, if they depend on former wages. if the real wages increases very quickly, then the pensions, which depend on the wages, well, of some years back, these pensions will be relatively lower. And reverse mechanism applies to crisis years when real wages decline, which is what we observed actually in Belgium between 1976 and 1985. Well, some of you may recall that The end of the 70s and the first half of the 80s were really crisis years with little economic growth, high unemployment. And what you observed that actually inequality declined in Belgium in those years. And the reason was that, well, wages indeed were stagnant, but the pensions moved up because they were linked to wages because the older people with low pensions were replaced by newer cohorts of pensioners who had higher pensions because their pensions were related to later wages. So having reviewed well, very briefly the theory, what is the empirical evidence on the relation between economic growth and inequality? And there's a review article by François Bourguignon of the World Bank, and he says, well, if you look at all the evidence that is now available, there's essentially no clear conclusion. The distribution effects of growth, they can go both ways. Sometimes it is inequality enhancing, sometimes inequality reducing. And as an illustration of this, inequality actually declined in almost all developed countries in the 1960s and 1970s. And these were years of very high economic growth. On the other hand, economic growth again picked up between 1980 and the middle of the 90s. And then we saw that inequality increased substantially in a number of countries, but not in all countries. It increased in particular in the Anglo-Saxon countries and in particular in the United States and the United Kingdom. and this is illustrated in these graphs. Which show inequality trends for some OECD countries where long-term data are available. And I guess you cannot see the... I'm not sure whether you can see all the countries' names. But what's interesting are the broad patterns. And you see that indeed in a number of countries... the graph starts left at 1965. And this is about 1985. And you see that indeed inequality declines, in particular in a number of countries like Sweden, Finland, France, also Germany, but and after this, after 95, we see rather steep increase in inequality, in particular in the United Kingdom. But also, maybe surprisingly, in Sweden. And in Finland, below that, but not in all countries. For instance, in France, we see that inequality continues to fall. That is this graph. If you look at what is behind those changes, there are actually two long-term trends. First of all, if you look only at market income, so at what people get out of wages, self-employment income, capital income, then we see more or less in almost all countries a continuous increase in inequality between starting from 1965. So market income inequality increases in almost all countries. So why does not this not translate into increase in disposable income? Well, the reason is that the equalizing effect of taxes and transfers, government taxes and government benefits, has also increased across the whole period. But in particular, you see the broad pattern, in particular between 65 and 19, the middle of the 1980s, say around 95. After that, it levels off a bit. So the reason that we saw a fall in inequality between in 60s and 70s was that really the development of the welfare state in many countries where taxes were increased and also benefits were increased strongly. And the reason that we saw an increase in inequality after 1985 is basically that the welfare state has not developed anymore, has become smaller in some countries, but in most countries has stabilized. So that was inequality. I come now to the second point, which is about economic growth and household formation. maybe not the first subject you will think about, but actually economic growth is associated with important changes in household formation. And this may weaken the link between economic growth and the material standard of living. In particular, it appears that as countries become richer, the average family size becomes smaller. And because there are economies of scale in large households, this in itself reduces the standard of material, standard of living. Two people can live more cheaply than one because they have to pay only for one house. And they have only to heat, etc., one house. So the more people live together, they can profit from these economies of scale and have a higher standard of living. This does not mean that these reductions in average family size that they have, they may increase welfare in themselves, which I will show this below. Unfortunately, there seem to be few systematic studies of the relation between economic growth and household formation. So my discussion is a bit qualitative. So why does economic growth, is it associated with a smaller average family size? There are three basic reasons. First of all, the number of children declines. So in the more developed countries, women get fewer children than in the less developed countries. And there are good reasons for this, which are well known from the development literature. Children are less needed for old age security. Parents, they decide to invest in the quality of children, by which mostly means education of children rather than the quantity of children, and also associated with the other point, because of this, children become more expensive in richer countries. And also, of course, developed economies have more labor market opportunities for married women, and this also leads to fewer children. But of course, this applies only if you compare developed countries with less developed ones, among OECD countries, there's no clear relation between fertility and GDP level. Other effects become more important. In particular, effects among adults. What happened is that certainly in earlier stages of development, children leave home earlier. This is what in particular happened in countries like Belgium, the Netherlands, Germany, in the 60s and 70s, where young people wanted to get out of their parents' home as soon as possible. That means as soon as they could afford it. So higher wages meant that they married early and started their own home. Also, what we see is that more people are single in the age range 20 to 65. Because some people never marry, and also do not formally, children who never married, most of them stayed with their parents, but this is no longer the case. And secondly, because of divorce, there are a number of reasons why divorce has increased in many countries over the last decades. But one reason is certainly that women have more income opportunities outside marriage. Many married women still continue to work, so they have a job. And other women can rely on state benefits for their income outside marriage. But of course, this leads perhaps to a lower material standard of living, but on the other hand, apparently this is what people want, otherwise they would not do it. If the children leave their parents' home earlier, this is because they want to have a home of their own, and the same applies to women who decide to divorce their husband. This is because they want this and think they have a better life outside marriage. Whether they are correct in this is another matter. Finally, there are effects for the elderly. What we see is that over the last decade, there are fewer multi-generational families, so where elderly persons over 65 live together with the adult children. This is of course because the children leave the parents' home earlier, but also because parents do not live with their children if they get very old and in need of care. They want to stay independent as long as possible. And as long as possible means a longer time if the pensions improve, if they have higher pensions, and also if the formal care facilities improve. And again, this seems to be what older persons prefer. They do not want to be dependent on their children. But then of course you may think, is this true? Well, this appears to be certainly true in northern and central European countries, but perhaps not in the southern European countries. We see these developments in these countries are much less prominent. In countries like Spain, also Italy, Greece, Portugal, there's still a lot of multi-generational families. Say close between 30 and 50% of 65 plus people are living with their children, or children are living with those parents. And this appears to be unrelated to the income or health needs of the parents. What is behind this? Some people say because in countries like Spain, there's a more familistic culture where the family is more valued, more than privacy. Others say it is hotel mama. I'm not sure whether this concept is well known around here, hotel mama. It means that adult children stay with their mother because the mother does everything for them. Cooks their food and do their washing, while especially the men, can do whatever they like. On the other hand, it may also be driven by the needs of the young people, not the elderly people. Some say, well, this pattern that we see in European, southern European countries, that is because young people suffer from high unemployment, low wages, and high housing costs. But I guess you are better placed to judge what is the truth here than I am. I'm not sure where the break is planned.
No, you have the time. Hmm? At half past 10.
Okay. So, and discussion will be afterwards, or?
Before break, you can have a couple of questions.
Because now I'm...
How many times have you now? How many times have you done discussing?
This subject will be 15 minutes, 20 minutes. Okay.
15 minutes.
Okay. So this brings us to the third subject, or domain, if you like, which is a very important one, of course. Relation between economic growth, employment, and unemployment. where I will talk about, first overall employment, and we will see that there is really no relation there. But what effects of economic growth are on the composition of the labor force in terms of sex and age. And as we will see, there is a concentration of employment across the life cycle and across households. And this has important effects on income distribution and on leisure. Finally, I will say something about the relation between economic growth and unemployment and related subject, jobless families. overall employment. And of course, in the short term, it is true, that macroeconomic shocks have effects on the employment. If there is an economic crisis for whatever reasons, for instance, because of high oil prices, then the number of employment will go down, and if economic growth picks up again, then employment will go up. But these are only short-term fluctuations. In the long term, it seems that overall employment is not affected by economic growth. rather, it's the other way around. Employment rate is determined by what economists call supply factors, which means institutions like the family, like the state, etc. The culture can be a part, in particular for labor market participation of women, seems to be that the culture or the values of can play a part, and of course education is very important. And this kind of factors determines how many people participate in the labor market. And what in the long term, economic growth is not so much related to the number of people in employment, but to the productivity of those people in employment. And you can only achieve economic growth if this productivity increases over time. And this is illustrated in this graph. so this is employment rate in all OECD countries. between 1970 and 2006. And you see the yellow line in the middle, it is nearly, between 1970 and 2006, it is nearly constant. It rises a bit from 65 to 68, but this is for a period of 35 years, this is of course a very small increase. So there is really overall stability, but at the same time, the labor employment rate among men goes down from 85 to below 80, and at the same time, the employment rate of women increases substantially from 45 to nearly 60%. And we see in the fluctuations, we see the economic crisis. You can see between 74 and 76, you see the drop, especially for men, due to the first oil crisis. And then in 1978, 1980, you see the effects of the second oil crisis. You see also that and then you see 86, 88, that it goes up a bit because the economy picks up again. And then you see the result of the crisis associated with the first Iraq war. And what's interesting also is that if you have a crisis, the employment rate among men drops. But then if economic growth is restored, the employment rate of men does not really go up again, or only very little. So it's a kind of ratchet effect, as they say. It goes down sometimes if things are bad, but it does not go up when things are good. So there's a long-term decline. And for women, it's more or less the opposite story. At the same time, you see also important changes by age. First of all, you see the black line is the employment rate among young people, which goes down from, say, about 50 to a bit under 40%. This is not OECD, but the EU 19 European Union countries. There are fluctuations, but the long-term trend is clear, I guess. Then the yellow line is the employment rate among men 55-64, which also goes down very substantially from about 70% in 1970 to a low of 48-47 in the late 90s. And then in the last years, it has picked up again a bit. But still, we see a very substantial long-term decline among older men. By contrast, if you look at the purple line, these are employment rate for men and women between 25 and 55. And there we see a long-term increase. It goes up all the time. And this is, of course, mainly due to married women getting paid to work. The employment rate among men in this age group has always been very high, 25 to 55. So this is what I just told you. Well, decline among young people is of course due to longer education, more and more young people get higher education, and this will mean that they are not employed for a while. And well, the drop among older men is due to early retirement, for whatever reason. This can be really early retirement, but also many of them are disabled, have invalidity pensions, and or are simply unemployed. Employment rate of women increases, of men decreases, and this is related to Another shift we see at the same period, which is the reduction of employment in manufacturing, say traditional blue collar work, and increase in employment among services. That is both government services, hospitals, government, etc., and also in private services, shops, and etc. And these shifts have an important. these shifts have important consequences for the income distribution. Because especially increase in employment rate of married women, because it's logically it leads to a strong rise in the number of dual earner families, the number of couples where both the wife and the husband earn an income. And this leads to a polarization between, on the one hand, the dual earner families with very high incomes, and on the other hand, the one earner families, which have generally lower incomes, and especially the zero earner families, where there is no one in paid employment, which are called by now the jobless families. I will go into that later below. because the dual earner families, they more or less set the norm for what is a normal standard of living. And the one earner and certainly the one benefit families, the families which have only one state benefit, they have a hard time keeping up to this norm. This is particularly clear in the housing market, where you see many young couples, both of them working, and they try to buy a house, the best house they can afford, the biggest house they can afford. So they set the prices, which become ever more expensive, house prices, and these house prices are simply not, cannot be paid by if people have less than two incomes. It also has important consequences for the timing of leisure. So as we saw that time at work, the period in their life when people work, is increasingly concentrated in the age range 25 to 50 or 55. And this is of course the same time when people raise their children, buy and build a home, and also most of them also have a lot of other social activities. And as you may experience yourself perhaps, this results in for many of people in those, in their especially in the 30s, the feelings of stress and frenzy. Many people lead very hectic lives, trying to organize their work and their family life and their social life at the same time. And this is enhanced by the fact that there's ever higher demands on productivity. The people, many jobs people have to really put in a great deal of effort to do what they have to do. And also on flexibility. People have to adapt very quickly to changing circumstances. Another factor, maybe not important here, I'm not sure, but certainly in Belgium, difficulty in getting from home to work. Because of the traffic conditions, many people spend 1 hour, 2 hours. I myself spend 3 hours a day getting from home to work and back again. And this, of course, only adds to this stress factor. And this also means that many people want to retire early. So they say, well, if the children have got their education, then I want to enjoy life again. And this is made possible by the fact that people indeed earn high wages So they can afford to retire early. So now I turn to unemployment. And also here, as we saw unemployment, the relationship between economic growth and unemployment is in fact rather weak. You might think that, well, if you have economic growth, then people get into employment, and unemployment goes down. Well, this was the old story, which was more or less true in the 1960s, maybe 1950s, but no longer. You see there the conclusion from a study by the OECD, and they say, well, while policies, institutions appear to play a major role, they are the most important factors shaping employment patterns and also unemployment level, macroeconomic conditions also matter, which is, well, they also matter, but they are of much less importance. And it appears that unemployment cannot really be reduced by economic growth, but only by specially targeted measures, which is active labor market policies. that means giving people training, special training, having special programs to put people in employment, from employment into work, reduction of unemployment traps. Unemployment trap means that the benefit is so high or the wage they can earn is so low that if people start working again, they become financially no better off. And of course, then people stay in unemployment. And this is what the OECD recommends to work on if you want to reduce unemployment. And this is also true, well, certainly in the long term. Long-term economic growth will not necessarily and even not lead to reduction in unemployment. And it's even true that a high growth rate may have a negative unemployment effect. That is, the higher the growth rate, the more unemployment you have. Maybe surprising, but good reasons for this. As I said before, economic growth is often achieved by increases in productivity, because productivity increases, but this, well, after a while also leads to higher wages. If people are more productive, they demand higher wages, and higher wages may mean that less productive people are put out of work. And also, economic growth can be associated with rapid structural change, where some sectors of the economy scale down, others go up, but this increases frictional unemployment, which is what we saw in the 70s and 80s, where a lot of manufacturing closed down, a lot of factories closed down, a lot of people were put into unemployment. At the same time, or later, the services, employment in services went up, but the typical factory worker did not find a job as a nurse in a hospital. So that also leads to unemployment. Well, one particular aspect of unemployment is, well, is jobless family, or not, rather not employment, is jobless families. And in the EU policy documents, sorry, they identify jobless families as a particular bad thing for social integration. They see this as a very negative phenomenon. Well, jobless families are families with non-elderly persons. It does not apply to people over 65, of course, because they are by definition jobless. but people at an age where they are normally expected to work, but still where no person in that family has a paid job during the entire year. And persons, the EU says that persons in those jobless families, but especially the children of those persons, are at a very high risk of social exclusion. Several reasons. First of all, well, by definition, they are dependent on state benefits, which tend to be quite low, so they have in all countries a very high poverty rate. Secondly, because they have so weak attachment to the labor market, it may be difficult for them to find a job again. This tends to be the case that people in jobless families, for instance, because they do not have the habits that the employer asks for any person in employment, they find it very difficult to find a job. And in particular for their children, this may have very negative effects for their later life. And it turns out that the relation between employment growth, so even if employment increases, and change in jobless households is rather weak. So even if employment increases, the number of jobless in families goes down, yes, but not very much. You can see this in this graph, where on the horizontal axis you have the increase in the employment rate between 2001 and 2005, and on the vertical axis you have the change in the proportion of jobless or the percentage of jobless families. And the points are the various EU countries, European Union countries. And we see there is indeed a relation, well, unsurprisingly, but perfectly. So if you have high unemployment, high increase in employment rate, you have fewer jobless families. But still, if you look at those countries, which include Austria, France, Belgium, they have a positive employment growth, so more people are in employment, but still the number of jobless families actually increases. And even if you have some countries with quite substantial increase in employment, for instance, Spain and Greece there, so 4% increase in employment rate, but still the number of jobless families goes down very little, only by 1 percentage point. This is what I just said. I thought I had a slide explaining why this is the case. Well, I can explain in words the reason. The reason for the weak relationship is that if the employment rate increases, the new jobs go mainly to two kinds of persons. First of all, married women. And secondly, young people just starting on the labor market. But both these people, married women and those young people, they live in families where most of the time there was already another person working, the husband or the parents. So, and what we see is that the people in the jobless families, they do not profit from the increase in employment. So I guess here we have to stop for the moment.
Muy bien, pues nada, damos las gracias a Karen Van den Bosch por esta primera parte de la presentación. Y ahora, siguiendo un poquito el programa, pues haríamos 15 minutos de descanso y a las 11:45 reanudamos la segunda parte y quizá termine también algo de esta primera. Vale.